much for inviting me to give this presentation today about photodynamic cancer therapy. Maybe it's a little bit different because, you know, I'm more clinical doctor. From my history, I'm a degreed biochemist, so I have a little bit background also in chemistry. But I'm working in internal medicine in my own clinic for about 35 years already. And in the last 20 years, we focused more on laser therapy. We used laser therapy first for pain management. And since about 10 years, we are using laser therapy, especially for photodynamic cancer therapy. So let me explain a little bit what we are speaking about and give you a short introduction of the mechanism of PDT, photodynamic therapy. First of all, this is nothing new. PDT has a long history already. And if you look at this timetable, you see that already about 100 years ago, already there was research and first treatments with so-called hematoporphyrins to treat cancers. Later, in about 50 years ago, already the first tumors were treated with porphyrin derivatives and also topically with 5-aminolevulinic acid. And now in the last years, more and more focus is on photodynamic therapy because it's a wonderful alternative to traditional cancer therapy like chemotherapy and radiation and others. I will not say that we don't need chemo as something. So I think we all need this and everything has its background, but photodynamic therapy is a wonderful addition to all these different treatments. Because if you compare with chemotherapy, photodynamic therapy also kills tumor cells, maybe also metastasis, but will not break down other quickly developing cells in the body and like red or white blood cells and stimulate the immune system and will not break it down. So what means photodynamic therapy is not difficult to understand. We need a light sensitive substance. We all know the chlorophyll in the nature, for example, is a light sensitive substance. And this substance can be stimulated by specific light according to its absorption spectrum. And then we get a so-called photosensitizer to an excited state. And then this energy is transferred to tissue oxygen to produce free radicals or singlet oxygen, which kill tumor cells. The photosensitizer itself is not a medicine, is only a substance what we use to pick up the photons, the photon energy, and transfer it to tissue oxygen. So it looks very easy, but if you look a little bit more in detail, it's a little bit more complicated. So again, if you look at this slide, you can see the photosensitizer again, stimulated by light to an excited state. And there are different ways what can happen. So first of all, we can get a so-called intersystem crossing. And some of the energy of the light can come back as so-called fluorescence with a lower energy, means a higher wavelength. We can use this for diagnostic purposes. And again, the light can come back as so-called phosphorescence with an, again, higher wavelength and lower energy. And then we have different pathways. So there can be a direct transfer to oxygen, developing of oxygen 3 oxygen, or then to O1. Or we also get in another pathway, hydrogen atoms and electron transfer and radicals. Yeah, this is very similar, but I want to show you with this slide that we cannot only destroy cancer cells. So we can destroy amino acids, nucleic acids, fatty acids, and also viruses, bacteria, fungi, and parasites. So photodynamic therapy is not limited only to cancer therapy. We also can kill microbes. What is very interesting, if we speak later some words maybe about the pandemic with COVID-19, because photodynamic therapy also can be used to kill viruses. Yeah, I want to show you in this picture again, photosensitizer, ROS, a reactive oxygen species, which can then damage viral DNA or RNA proteins and lipids. Yeah, we use different lasers of different wavelengths. You know, we have the full spectrum of light, beginning with UV, and then comes the blue, the green, the yellow, and the red one, and infrared one. That's the full spectrum of light. You can see these are the available lasers in the moment, what we are using for our therapy, starting with ultraviolet, 375 nanometers, different blue ones, 405, 447, green 532, yellow 589, different red ones, 632 and 660, and infrared 810 or 785. So we are in the happy situation that we have a very good supplier for lasers, and when I want any new laser, any new wavelength, they can make it for me. And this is very important because when we use different substances, they all have a different absorption spectrum, and we have to use the right laser with the right wavelength that we get maximum absorption and excitation of the substance to get a so-called good quantum yield of oxygen radicals. Yeah, later I will show you a little bit about the new technology, because you know photodynamic therapy is used for many years. I told you already, give a photosensitizer and then give the laser from outside to the body. The problem is in photodynamic therapy, and that's the biggest limitation. Yeah, you can read, if you look in Google about PDT, you find thousands of very good publications, but everywhere is written, it's a wonderful therapy, it's the perfect therapy for cancer, but the limitation is that the laser can penetrate only maybe some millimeters or maximum maybe some centimeters into the body. So we cannot achieve any good results if we treat deeper cancers like lung, breast, or pancreatic cancer, sarcomas, or anything else. And we have developed a new technology using so-called interstitial needles. These are needles from different lengths with integrated fiber optics with which we can bring all the different lasers everywhere, ultrasound or MRI guided, into the body. Yeah, here's some pictures about the mechanism. So when you give the photosensitizer, this will be integrated or attached to the cancer cell, give the right light. Then we produce the so-called damaged material patterns, you know, that's the breakdown of the cell. And the good thing is that the body can start an immune reaction on this. Yeah, and what is also very important, we induce something like an inflammation and also break down the small supporting blood vessels of the tumor by thrombosis. Yeah, here you see a typical example. For example, there is maybe a tonsil cancer or something in the mouth. Yeah, you give the photosensitizer administration first. Then you have normally a good targeting. That's where the targeting is the main issue, that you really, really reach this area. And then we have an accumulation of the photosensitizer in the tumor tissue. And then we irradiate with the right wavelength, which can lead to breakdown of the tissue and also of thrombosis of the tumor supporting blood vessels. And we induce a huge immune reaction. You see in the left side of this slide, we produce the ROS by the right light and integrated photosensitizer. We have the breakdown, and on the broken material of the tumor, this will be taken up by macrophage and by phagocytosis. We have maturation of dendritic cells and a huge immune response. Yeah, what are photosensitizers? This is normally easy to understand. Photosensitizers, the current photosensitizers on the market, are mostly derived from the porphyrin molecule. And you know, the porphyrin molecule is the basic molecule of our hem or of the chlorophyll. But you know, in the hem, we have an iron inside for taking up oxygen. In the chlorophyll, we have magnesium inside. And if you take the metal out, we have a photosensitizer. And then we call them hematoporphyrins or hematoporphyrin derivatives or chlorines. Here you see a list. Here on the right side, the porphyrin molecule. And on the bottom, you see different kinds of porphyrin derivatives and chlorophyll derivatives, which are already on the market and used. However, only for superficial tumors. Here again, some formulas. Porphyrin, chlorine, bacterial chlorine, and some phthalocyanins are synthetic porphyrins. And you see there's already an approval long time for photosensitized. This is not an alternative. It is really an accepted therapy, but only in early cancer. Yeah? Early cancer, for example, Barrett dysplasia in esophageal cancer, cervical cancer, gastric cancer, but only on the surface, because with all this porphyrin-derived photosensitizer, we only can achieve some millimeters of effective penetration depth. Yeah, because they all work with red light, yeah, with red laser. And red laser has a limited penetration, maybe maximum 1 to 2 centimeters. Yeah, currently used photosensitizers, photofreen is an approved substance, even from the FDA in the American market. Chlorine E6 works with red laser. Very interesting is indocyanine green. We will speak a little bit later about this in liposomes or micelles. Works with infrared laser, which has a much deeper penetration into the tissue and also is able to penetrate bones. There are also some natural substances like hypericin, from St. John Paul's plant, curcumine, everybody knows this, or riboflavin is vitamin B2, which has a very nice antiviral effect. Interestingly, we can also use chemo drugs as photosensitizers. Then we can call them chemosensitizers. So that means we give them in a low dose and stimulate them and make them more effective by a special laser therapy according to their absorption spectrum. For example, doxorubicin works with blue, mitoxantrone with yellow and red. Then the non-colored substances like the taxan, cisplatin, or 5-fluorouracil works mostly with ultraviolet light. Now, how can we use photodynamic in a clinical setting? First of all, we can use it topically. There are some photodynamic creams, what we can put maybe on actinic keratosis, basal cell carcinoma, something what is growing only on the surface of the body. So the mostly used is 5-aminolevulinic acid, 5-ALA. It's a part of the photofreen molecule. If you divide this in different parts, you get this substance. And you see the absorption spectrum is mainly blue and red one. And so here, a typical example for actinic keratosis, you give the cream on this, you wait 3 hours that it can bind to the abnormal cells, and then it's irradiated here maybe for 10 minutes, and normally it's gone. It's a wonderful therapy, and it's approved everywhere. Or look at this example for BCC carcinoma, works very well. Another picture from one of my patients here, the surgeons want to cut out a big piece. And the good thing is you can do it several times, like a sandwich therapy, you know, step by step. You can remove the first 2 or 3 millimeters, you wait 2 weeks, you have to make it again. There is no limitation, and you see here the final result, which was very good. On the other hand, what is very interesting, I told you before, when we have a photosensitizer and we stimulate it, of course, we get the oxygen radicals. But on the other hand, the light also can come back in a different wavelength, normally higher wavelength, what we can use for photodynamic diagnostic. So this is a typical basal cell carcinoma on the nose, and we put 5-ALA cream on it, and then we irradiate after 3 hours with blue light, stimulate the photosensitizer, and we see the red fluorescence. So we can also see really how big this tumor is. Or this patient was operated 10 times on the nose with a recurrent BCC cancer. And you see here the photodynamic diagnostic with blue light. And after diagnostic, we irradiate 10 minutes with red light to remove everything, and this works very well. Another example, patient here with superficial tongue cancer. Here you can see the fluorescence again. This is a patient from India, which I treated in my clinic in Bangkok. So I have one clinic here in Germany, another one in Bangkok in Asia. So unfortunately, I could not work there in the last year because everything was closed down. But we will start soon again here. And I treated her 3 times. This was a very advanced case of breast cancer. And normally it was very difficult to treat. And you see here the fluorescence with 5-LA cream. And at the end, we get a wonderful result. I'll show you some pictures later. This is a patient with superficial spreading of breast cancer, also with diagnostic. Interestingly, also, we can treat very well with 5-aminolevulinic acid cervix dysplasia or superficial cervix cancer. We use normally a portio cap, you know, what we can fill up with 5-LA and put it on the portio. And then you see on the right side, we can make a fluorescence diagnostic. Here you see the portio cap and then irradiate with a small applicator intravaginally and with very, very good success. And you know, there are thousands of women, you know, and running to the gynecologist all the time because they have pre-cancer. And so normally, studies show the efficacy is more than 90%. So, but when we have a cancer systemically in the body, so we have to use the photosensitizer intravenously. And I give you the principle. So maybe we use photofreen or maybe chlorine-6, which is quite common in Germany. We inject it and it's then in the bloodstream maybe 30 minutes. And especially chlorine-6 was very quickly picked up from the tumor cells, mostly by LDL receptors. And it takes about 3-4 hours. Then it's a maximum absorption. If it's superficially, you know, we can check it also with the fluorescence, what I showed you before, which of course is not working in the depth of the body. Then normally we irradiate up to 15 minutes, about 1000 joule. Energy, you know, energy is power times time. And if everything works well, we get necrosis, apoptosis in about 24, 48 hours. This is the typical excitation absorption spectrum of chlorine-6. And I compared here in this picture chlorine-6 with photofreen. And you see the effective penetration depth is low. Now, maybe maximum 1.5, 2 centimeters. So anything is deeper in the body, we cannot expect a good result. This patient came from Austria and he had pain in the mouth and they took a biopsy and showed this was a cancer in this area. So we gave him chlorine-6 and made the blue light, you know, with fluorescence. Then irradiation here with red 660 nanometers for 10 minutes with 500 milliwatt. And you see the next day, usually you can see the necrosis and the area where the tumor is growing. I treated this Thai patient in my clinic in Bangkok, young man with tongue cancer. And also we can see here the fluorescence radiation. And we got a very good result after 4 weeks. Yeah, however, the problem is what I told you before. The key is that we get enough light into the tissue to stimulate the photosensitizer. And if we use red light, like in this picture from outside, we can expect maybe an effective penetration depth of maybe 1 centimeter. But if the tumor in the lymph nodes maybe is deeper or in the breast is maybe 3-4 centimeters deep, nothing will work. Yeah. And the only chance to overcome this problem is a so-called interstitial photodynamic therapy. So we have developed a device here in Germany which can deliver all the different colors, like red, infrared, green, blue, yellow, ultraviolet. So everything in one device, we call it endolaser, is an approved system on the market. It's even approved in the US by the FDA for 10 years already. We have fiber optic puncture needles of different lengths, you need small butterflies or plastic cannula like this, or we use interstitial fiber optic catheters, needle length up to 12 centimeters, so that we really can reach nearly all areas in the body. Yeah, and there was a very nice publication from Professor Vogel from University of Frankfurt in 2004 already, using fiber optics in liver metastasis with photosensitizers and put different catheters inside and achieved a very good result. But why did this therapy not come in the mainstream? I tell you, because there was no device on the world with which you can make it. Yeah? So we developed this device with help of the German government. We had a good funding of our government in Hannover, Niedersachsen, Lower Saxony, so that we can set up an approved device. So this is a typical interstitial therapy of lymph nodes of breast cancer. And then is the next problem. You know, if we put different needles into a tumor, we set only different points. Yeah, and maybe we will not reach the whole tumor area. So how can we solve this problem? Here you see there are different types of catheters, and some catheters on the left side, they only make a point, you know. But ideally, we need a catheter with a cylindrical circular irradiation to fill up the whole tumor with light. And that's another development what we made in Germany. You see here this kind of catheter, which makes a circular irradiation with different lasers on the last 5 centimeters on the end. So these are first treatments what we did in the past. So for different lymph nodes here, melanoma patient or thyroid cancer. And here you see the new development of the cylindrical fiber optics, what we can put in the tissue with a wonderful spreading of light. Here you see this patient of breast cancer with a very good result. Yeah, especially in urology, it's very interesting. You know, most cancers what we have in Maine is prostate cancer. We have also many bladder cancers or lung cancers. So for urology, we have developed a special catheter which has a hole at the end. We use this type of fiber optics. You see, for example, with red light, and we can put it in the catheter. Yeah, in the last 5 centimeters, then it's in the urethra within the prostate. So we fill up the prostate with light. Or for bladder, we push the catheter through the hole at the end of the catheter and can fill up the whole bladder with light. So it looks like in this picture. And here you can see. Also, we can use it for intrarectal treatment as well when we treat prostate cancer. Here we can use different lights. One of my patients years ago with bladder cancer, chlorine E6, and with one treatment till today after 5 years, no relapse again. Yeah, we can use this fiber optics also very well in gastroenterology, in esophageal cancer, in stomach cancer. We also can put these catheters with the bronchoscope in the bronchial system. And here you see a typical picture of esophageal cancer. Yeah, here's stenosis, and this is so thin and flexible, it's from plastic, you know, and we can put it even in stenosis without making any damage. And even if it's plastic, we can use up to 2 watt of laser energy. Yeah, besides the porphyrin-derived photosensitizers, there are other natural substances, what we also use on the side. A wonderful substance is hyperosine from the St. John's plant. It works, is a red substance, the flower is yellow, and it works with yellow light, 589 nanometers, here a picture. Everybody knows curcumin. Many doctors give curcumin on the side. You know, curcumin itself has a inhibitory effect on developing of metastasis, but we use curcumin as photosensitizers. It works with blue light, 447 nanometers. Another very interesting photosensitizer which works with blue light is riboflavin, vitamin B2, which is a wonderful substance what the body needs anyway. You see the absorption spectrum, mainly 370 nanometers UVA light and 447 nanometers blue light. And here you see on the right side, the fluorescence, you irradiate, you put it in the mouse as a spray, you give ultraviolet light and you see the green fluorescence. So you can really prove that it's a photosensitizer. And we have developed different adapters for nose and mouth, you see, and this is a wonderful treatment for killing coronavirus. I published in the US in January a study using riboflavin as a capsule and additionally as a spray and irradiating with ultraviolet light and blue light. And within minutes, we can kill all the viruses. This is an interesting therapy. Here you see the results of our study on 140 patients from end of 2020. And you see in the PDT group, the efficacy when we measure the so-called cycle threshold values going up, that means the virus is destroyed, and in the control group nearly no effect. But this is only something on the side, only to show you the big value of photodynamic therapy. And not all people die from cancer. Still, we have a lot of infectious diseases on the world, yeah? Dengue fever, malaria, now COVID-19. And PDT is a wonderful tool, yeah, to attack not only cancer cells, but also microbial and infectious diseases. A very new substance, what we developed with the University of Marburg, is a very old traditional university close to Frankfurt, is indocyanine green. Indocyanine green is a well-known substance, even approved on the US market for 50 years, and it's used mainly for fluorescence diagnostics. So you can inject it, and then you can show with infrared light, maybe the blood flow in different arteries, in liver, heart, or in carotid artery. And it's a wonderful photosensitizer. Especially it works with infrared light, which has a much deeper penetration. But unfortunately, it binds to albumin, and quickly after some minutes, it's out of the body. So with the University of Marburg, we put the indocyanine green in small particles like liposomes or micelles, you know, and then the particles, maybe 100 nanometers big, they stay in the circulation, will not go out of the kidney, and step by step, it takes a little bit time, will accumulate in tumor cells. And here you see the absorption spectrum. It's about 810. Sorry, I have to stop my phone. And here you see the micelles, liposomes are different nanoparticles, what can be used to put a lipophilic substance, you know, into a particle and then to integrate it into the cells. So in the past, mostly we used liposomes. Here you see a typical picture. And particle size about 100 nanometers. Here you can see in the electron microscope. And the here you see the infusion solution. Yeah, it will be dissolved about 150 milligram of nano-indocyanine green in glucose 5% solution. And here you see the integration into the cells, what is normally not possible. We need the special nanoparticles. And we know there's the so-called enhanced penetration and retention effect, the so-called EPR effect, because in the tumor tissue, the endothel has some more gaps, you know, that the nanoparticles can go through, what is not possible in normal blood vessels. So this explains why there is a better accumulation in the tumor tissue compared to the normal tissue, because it's very important, the specificity that the photosensitizer will not go in normal tissue and then we destroy healthy cells. And that's one of the biggest problems of old photosensitizers like Photofreen, which is still approved on the market, that people get light sensitive and you have a lot of collateral damage. So I personally don't like this substance. Here you see the wonderful penetration of infrared light. You can show it with the digital camera. You know, it penetrates the hand bones. Here, patient on infusion, and here you see the light penetration, the tissue with infrared 810, and we call it nano-indocyanine green. Here you see the spreading. We also use the specific catheters, what I showed you already. Here you see that it penetrates wonderful the bone in the nose. This is nasopharyngeal cancer. We use it for endoscopic treatment for esophageal cancer. Here you see the fiber optics coming through the endoscope. Some days later, you can see the necrotic area, here the white areas. And 4 weeks later, you can see the end effect. Yeah, on the other hand, we can stimulate photosensitizers also with ultrasound, not only with light, also with therapeutic ultrasound. And we call it photodynamic therapy if we do it with light, and if we do it with ultrasound, we call it sonodynamic therapy. Yeah, this is one of the devices on the market is from US, which delivers wonderful ultrasound, therapeutic ultrasound in combination with radio frequency. And here you see some sonosensitizers, and again you see here curcumin, indocyanine, hyperecine. So mostly all the important photosensitizers are also sonosensitizers, and the mechanism is very similar, but there are some differences. We also can produce oxygen radicals, but on the other hand, also we produce some bubbles inside. You know, they get bigger and bigger, and at the end, let the tumor cell explode. Another option is to combine PDT with stem cell therapy. Yeah, normally we use stem cells for regenerative medicine, but we know that stem cells can work as a carrier for photosensitizers for better targeting. You know, stem cells have the property that they go to areas in the body where there's inflammation, also a tumor is like inflammation in the body, and they can actively target the place of injuries or inflammation of tumors. So we have developed a new method to get stem cells from the fatty tissue. So we make a mini liposuction, and we get out the stem cells of the tissue with so-called indirect sonication to get the so-called stroma vascular fraction. So in the cyberphotometry, we can measure the amount of cells. You know, it's always a mixture of cells, not only stem cells. And then we can inject it together with the photosensitizer into the bloodstream for achieving a better targeting and accumulation. Another option is to stimulate the bone marrow. There are very good publications from Israel showing that you can activate bone marrow stem cells by infrared laser. They made a lot of animal experiments, but we have big, yeah, thick bones, so it's difficult to get infrared laser through. So we make a small hole with the drill machine and put the catheter inside and can irradiate the bone marrow stem cells directly inside the bone and to activate them and bring them out in the system. There's a lot of work already done on nanoparticle-loaded stem cells to bring them together in the circulation, showing that there is a better accumulation and after irradiation, a better quantum yield of reactive oxygen species. Stem cells also are able to carry photosensitizers into brain tumors through the blood-brain barrier. Yeah, or here another publication, stem cells loaded with nanoparticles as a drug carrier for in vivo breast cancer therapy, or nano-engineered mesenchymal stem cells increase therapeutic efficacy of anti-cancer drugs through true active tumor targeting. Yeah, so we are using different devices. I'll show a little bit what we are doing in our clinic. We, after application of photosensitizers, we can area the whole area from outside, of course, with devices with a lot of different diodes here, infrared. We also have developed a light bed with 10,000 diodes. You see here a breast cancer patient inside, 10,000 diodes, 10 milliwatt for backside and frontal side irradiation. I like this device very much. It delivers 3,500 watt red and also infrared light. You can switch on both colors according to your photosensitizer. So the patient then can turn and we can irradiate east side and we have a very good penetration. For brain tumors, we have developed a specific brain irradiation device. And another problem, what I want to emphasize on this this point is, and I think we heard it already in other lectures today, is the hypoxemia of the tumors. Yeah, the tumor can grow without oxygen. You know this. Yeah, the tumor can it can metabolize the glucose to lactate, which makes also hyperacidity, also which can then stimulate further tumor growth and metastasis. So, and if we have not enough oxygen in the tumor, nothing will work. Chemo, radiation, photodynamic therapy, nothing will work. And it's always the question, how can we get more oxygen into the body? So there's a lot of studies, if you look in the literature, to attempts to bring more oxygen in tumor tissue. Very easy is a so-called normobaric oxygenation, only let the patient breathe oxygen, but you cannot increase the oxygen pressure in the tissue and the bloodstream a lot. So one option, what we are doing in our clinic is the hyperbaric chamber. Yeah, and then you have an a window, therapeutic window. If you take the patient out of the hyperbaric chamber, you have about 30 minutes to use the hyperbaric oxygen. So after this hyperbaric treatment, we have to use the PDT immediately after this treatment. There is an interesting protocol, we call it Koto protocol, developed in Japan. They developed from some radiologists. They mixed hyaluronic acid together with hydrogen peroxide, and this will bind to each other, then inject into tumors, and this will deliver oxygen over 24 hours into the tumor tissue. And they have wonderful results. And also we get an inactivation of increased peroxidase. Yeah. So this is a very interesting therapy. So we also have put this in our protocol to use hyaluronic peroxide mixture into the tumor. So we mix 1% hyaluronic acid, 2 milliliters with 0.4 milliliters, 3% hydrogen peroxide, and then we inject it directly into the tumor tissue, and we have a window of 24 hours to make the treatment with our photosensitizers. So some only last pictures, some case reports. We have hundreds of patients now, and I will not say it's always working. Yeah, sometimes it's working well, sometimes not. And it depends, of course, on the tumor size. So if the tumor is very big, maybe 5 or 10 centimeters, normally is not working. And then it makes sense to give chemotherapy first or make a surgery first to decrease the tumor size, maybe to 2 or 3 centimeters. Then we have a good chance to get a result. Here's some pictures in ultrasound, and you see the quick reduction of tumor size. Here I showed you this picture already from breast cancer with an excellent healing at the end. This was
Dr.
a patient.
Michael, sorry for the interruption.
Yeah, I'm ready. 1 minute, yeah? Yeah. You see a lot of metastasis with nano-ICG with a very good result. Maybe this is the last case report, an Italian patient with 8 centimeter breast tumor. And you see here the treatment on indocyanine green, ultrasound, and very good result at the end. And also in ultrasound, you can see at the end that the tumor tissue disappeared completely. Yeah, another one from breast cancer. And interestingly, if you have big sarcomas like this in the ultrasound, you can see the black areas where tumor areas are destroyed. Yeah, so this is, you see, it's a big field and we can discuss hours and a whole day about this. I hope I could give you a little bit explanation and maybe short introduction, and maybe you get some interest also in this field because it's a wonderful therapy. What we also can use very well as a combination therapy to all other cancer therapies, what we are doing today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Michael. Is there any questions from audience?
If there are any questions, please send also maybe email to weber@webermedical.com. Very easy. Yeah.
I have a quick question.
Go ahead.
Okay, I have a quick question. I saw it on the market. There's a beauty product that is infrared red light. They claim that it can improve the facial collagen and decrease wrinkles. Do you think that one will work?
Which one? You speak about infrared light?
Yeah, infrared light. It's currently on market, and they claim that when you use that infrared red light every day, it will decrease your wrinkles. Do you think that would work? That's
a different field. Of course, normally lasers are used for regenerative medicine, what I told you in the beginning. And lasers normally, you know, they will stimulate the cells, they will stimulate collagen production, and people use it for skin regeneration and hair growth and everything. This is a regenerative effect of lasers. And of course, we cannot use lasers alone on cancer. This will maybe stimulate the cancer growth. We can use, in this case, lasers only in combination with photosensitizers. Yeah, and that's the difference, you know, because in all the book, when you look in the old books, oh, laser is a contraindication for cancer therapy because it stimulates, and there's something true. But in combination with photosensitizers, you can do it. It's a complete different field.
Okay, I have another question about curcumin. So curcumin is supposed to be, if I understand it right, it's supposed to be the ingredient of turmeric.
Turmeric, right?
What kind of turmeric is the best for my curcumin intake then?
Oh, we get the curcumin from an American company in Oklahoma. I don't know exactly what's inside, but it's a turmeric. Yeah, it's a,
okay.
No, I don't know exactly which kind it is, but it's a very, very pure substance. And we also use it, we can use it intravenously, but we also can use it as a capsule. So it has also a good absorption. Normally curcumin is not well absorbed, maybe only 5%. And this is a curcumin bound to, yeah, like liposomes, you know, and you have an absorption up to 30-40%, which is very important. But curcumin has a laser effect, a photodynamic effect, and curcumin also has a so-called dark effect. So it's also working positively on development of metastasis without light, in contrast to chlorophyll, which works only with light.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, okay, my pleasure.
I have a question.
Michael?
Can you eradicate circulating tumor cells with this technology?
Yeah. I had not time to speak about this field. You know, we always combining after giving the photosensitizer, we also treat the bloodstream. We have developed in Germany, which is an approved therapy, so-called intravenous laser. So we put the catheter in the bloodstream, and after application of the photosensitizer, we can irradiate the blood and to destroy circulating tumor cells and maybe also tumor stem cells. And we have developed, I need more time to show you, but I can send you some publication if you like. We have developed a spectroscopic method to detect using indocyanine green and the fluorescence to detect single circulating tumor cells in the bloodstream. You know, we need a spectrometer, we connect the catheter to the spectrometer, we infuse some indocyanine green, we stimulate it, and then we can detect circulating tumor cells, and then we can treat them 30 minutes maybe with infrared laser, and then we can look and detect if they're gone or not. Yeah, it's a very interesting field. In the moment, they are planning to setting up 20 diagnostic centers only with this method for detection of circulating tumor cells. Also in after chemotherapy, we never know if there's still tumor cells, stem cells in the bloodstream. So this is a wonderful diagnostic tool, you know, for checking the patient after the therapy.
Thank you.
Send me an email and then I send you the publication about this. This is amazing new field.